Hello. Let's talk about mixing and palette knives. First off, you're going to want a palette knife that'll have some give to it for the most part. Not always, but for the most part. I want to show you the differences between some of these palette knives and why they're important. You'll notice this one is the Le Cornel J15. Now you can get this one at Michael's Arts and Crafts, possibly Hobby Lobby as well, but I haven't looked for it there, only at Michael's Arts and Crafts. And you'll notice that the handle is offset like that. Now this is actually a painting knife, and the reason it's a painting knife versus a palette knife is so that the artist can hold it, apply paint to surface, and not get their hands in the surface paint that's already on there. So this is actually a painting knife, but it's a wonderful mixing tool as well. And you'll notice when I do this, you can see that it's got a lot of spring to it. That little thin blade is what gives it that kind of spring, and it's really more beneficial when you're mixing paints. Because of that, you've got a lot of flexibility to that palette knife. The other one I absolutely love is the P16 Royal Langnickel. It's got a longer, and it is a true mixing knife. It's got a longer slim blade just like the other one, and it too has a lot of good spring tension to it. I love that. For extremely large projects, when I have to mix a lot of paint, in other words, a huge canvas, this is the smallest of the Bob Ross. You'll notice this long, thin edge here will allow you to very quickly scoop a lot of paint and mix it, smash it, and blend it. And it also works great for very stiff paints. And some of the paints have more pigment, and you'll find that they are stiffer. And sometimes they're going to need to really be beaten into submission. So the other thing is I think it's a B2 Langnickel. It's a very thick bladed, it doesn't have a huge lot of spring, and its spring tends to come more at the handle rather than in the blade itself, and that's another good one for mixing a large body of paint. So those are the palette knives that you can have in your supply, but really you can do pretty much everything with one of the two smaller ones, and these are the types of palette knives that I would recommend that you get. The other thing that you're going to want to have in your mixing supplies are these handy dandy little toothpicks. For those of you that know me, a toothpick was my instant joy of discovery because I was having a terrible time trying to figure out how to get just the right amount of paint on the end of one of these little palette knives. And sometimes I just would get way too much. Well, I discovered that the end of a toothpick, I mean, we're talking a minuscule, pinhead-sized pea amount of paint is all that's needed sometimes to mix with another color to get that third color. So have toothpicks. Doesn't matter if they're flat. Doesn't matter if they're round. I'm having trouble finding the flat-headed toothpicks anymore, so I just switched over to the round ones and found them in these little dispensers. I think it's a Dollar Tree or something. But get toothpicks. You'll find they're very, very beneficial for your painting table. The other thing that I would recommend you have are paper towels, because you're going to need to clean that palette knife constantly when you're mixing. And don't forget to clean your edges. Those little slivers of metal there will carry paint, and when you go to dip into your other color, and especially your titanium white, you'll find that color has transferred because there is still paint on the edge. So be sure to have paper towels. Now I use Viva, and the reason I use Viva is because it's more like cloth, and it'll handle this quite well, and I can use it, you know, a little bit better than another one, and also I can use it for my brushes, and it's not so harsh on my brushes, where a cheap paper towel has more paper content, paper dust to it, and it's very harsh on your towel, on your brushes. So anyway, keep your paper towels here. I cut mine into quarter sections and use those. Some people actually use even less than that. They'll take these and go even into four, so they've got more. But I just keep them handy, ready, willing. The other thing that I keep also are baby wipes, wonderful things. I get these at Walgreens or Walmart, I think, for like, I don't know, $1.86 or something. But I tend to be really messy, and so I keep those handy because otherwise I get paint all over everything and me. So another good tool. The other thing I want to talk to you about is having Mona Lisa odorless paint thinner. It is a good resource. I'm not sure if you can see inside of this jar, but there is a little cleaning grid in here. It's a metal screen, very wide screen, that allows you to dip the brush in the solution and then run the ferrule. And the ferrule is the metal part of your brush. Here. So when you bump on this edge here against that metal, it takes these bristles and moves them with that bumping motion in that solution and cleans them. You don't want to scrape your brushes against the metal, but you do want to scrape them against you want the ferrule to be scraped against it, like I'm doing here on the edge of that. When you bump that along, these are just so you can hear what I'm talking about. Can you hear that? That's the metal against the ferrule against the screen. And although the brushes are in the solution, the brushes are not being scrubbed against that screen. And that's the one thing I want to warn you about not doing, because you'll quickly ruin your brushes. That little tank I find at any hobby craft store. Michael's Arts and Crafts has them. I'm assuming, you know, Hobby Lobby would have them. I do use the Mona Lisa odorless thinner in here. I keep it right here next to my painting, because we're going to paint with that quite a lot. You'll discover that that will allow you to create washes, to quicker create a background color as an undercoating. For those of you using the acrylics, obviously you'll want a cleaning tank of some sort, your brush basin. That brush basin's bottom, the ridges on that work the same as your Mona Lisa tank does, really. The brushes, those ridges are just the same as that metal screen. Again, making sure that you only bounce the metal against those, not the brush fibers themselves. And so you should be all set there. Let's see if there's anything else we need to talk about here with our mixing. I don't think so. But anyway, the reason I brought the paint thinner in here is because sometimes I've got quite a bit of gunk on here mixing, and I'll just quickly run it through the brush cleaner, letting it bounce, and that'll help more quickly clean some of that solution or some of that paint off of here if I need it. So, okay, let's get on to the next one. Let's talk about brushes and go from there.